On today's Prophecy in the News, we're going to talk about a battle in the heavens. We know that during the last days, there will be a royal battle, not just on earth among humans, but between God's angels and the demonic forces of Lucifer. Gary Stearman is here to discuss with me this heavenly battle.
And J.R., the heavenly battle will rage in the last days, and I expect it'll come to a very great climactic end. But you know, it's been going on for centuries, and I think it goes on even as we speak. And we're going to look at the battle in the heavens really as an outgrowth of our conversations on the primeval light. We've discussed in earlier programs, J.R., that the battle really can be characterized as a battle of light versus darkness. The creatures of light, the angels, versus the creatures of darkness, led by the prince of darkness himself, Satan. And we're going to begin in Daniel as we look at this battle and try to get some insight into what's going on.
Now, Gary, we know there are angels, and we know there are demons. They must surely have some kind of interaction in this world. We have heard through history that there are, fairies and leprechauns and all kinds of folklore about some other unearthly, otherworldly creatures that are out there. And of course, in the Bible, we have the stories of angels interacting with people, and such will be the case today in Daniel chapter 10, as Daniel encounters an angel. The UFO phenomena of late surely must have some kind of connection, because there are too many of these reports for it to just be a figment of men's imagination.
Well, J.R., the many writers have pointed out the history of what are called demonic phenomena on the face of the earth. As you mentioned, fairy lore. There are legends of elves and little people, and there are legends concerning enchantments and spirit beings. All of this, I think, comes under the heading of demonic phenomena, even to the extent that the demons seem to be able to shift their field depending on which culture they're dealing with. For example, in the 19th century, we had the famous airship phenomena, in which what appeared to be helium balloons powered by old-fashioned steam engines would steam across the sky and occasionally land and ask for a drink of water. You know, the occupants there would ask the Farmer John if he had some water, and Farmer John would say, "Yes, I do. Where are you from?" And they'd say, "Well, we're from China." And this is extremely well documented, and what I believe was going on was that in every age there is a demonic presence, and it modifies itself to suit the current perception of technology. So today, the demons have said, "Well, let's see, what would modern man react to?" "I know, let's make ourselves look like space aliens."
Yes.
"We'll appear as space aliens, and we'll spread the lie that we're coming from outer space." And so,
and be in some kind of high-tech vehicles.
In a high-tech looking vehicle. And so the demonic lore has shifted with the culture down through the ages. For example, the days of Alexander the Great. Alexander and his men saw what they called a flying shield that was flying through the air, and it buzzed around over the troops. Well, today we'd call that a flying saucer. But the point is that in every age there has been an encounter with, let's call them flying angels, led by the prince of darkness, or the Bible calls him the prince of the power of the air. And this battle seems to be coming to a conclusion in our day, getting ready for a conclusion.
A lot of UFO flaps in the last few years.
That's right.
And another one, as I understand it, another one is on the way of beginning.
In Mexico, there have been just literally thousands of sightings, and people routinely take videotape films of little silver spheres flying around over Mexico City. Monterrey, Mexico, has been a big UFO site. And then this is sort of crept northward into the southern United States. Arizona has seen a number of UFO appearances, New Mexico, Texas now. And so, yes, we do appear to be having another, as it's called, UFO flap.
In the days of the Bible, the chariot was the vehicle of the mass or the armies and most populations. They had ox carts, some kind of vehicle pulled by horses, and that appears to be the description given of the heavenly vehicles that fly around, described in the days of Daniel. Let's talk about Daniel chapter 10 for just a moment. It says, in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a thing was revealed unto Daniel, but the time appointed was long. In other words, this thing that was revealed would take a long time to work out. And of course, this is following the abomination of desolation in the story of the 70 weeks. And so I get from this that the thing that was revealed to him was the information that had been given to him by Gabriel just a few verses prior to this, the 70 weeks, and the 70th week being the tribulation period and the abomination of desolation there.
And that's to be a time, we know from the book of Revelation, that's to be a time when this battle in the heavens really breaks out. It becomes, I think, highly visible. But in its invisible form, we read about it in the 10th chapter of Daniel, in which Daniel had fasted and prayed for 21 days and was visited by a vision of the pre-incarnate Christ, or let's put it this way, the same Christ that John saw in Revelation, the man in white linen. And then he was also visited apparently by an angel, and the Hebrew commentaries say it was the angel Gabriel. And Gabriel says to Daniel in Daniel 10:13, I heard your prayer 21 days ago. And then he says, but the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 120 days, but lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. And he's talking about something we would almost think of as a space battle. Maybe the airspace over Persia, in which these super beings are contesting within that region and going head to head and fighting each other. And here Gabriel says, it took me 21 days and I had to get Michael's help.
So this was an other dimensional type battle that was going on, not of among humans, but among angels and fallen angels.
Right.
The prince of Persia must have been a demonic being whose job it was to govern over the politics of the land in Persia at that time. Kind of interesting to me. Let's set the scene here. We've got Daniel down by the river.
Yes.
The river Hiddekel. And the more modern name for this river would be
the Euphrates.
The Euphrates River. And he sees a vision of this man. Now, over in chapter 12, this man clothed in linen is on the river. And I think that's kind of interesting that he sees this. The man clothed in linen, verse 6 of chapter 12, which was upon the waters of the river. So when Daniel looks out upon the river, he sees this man either in a boat or standing on the water. And he knows immediately that it is a heavenly being.
Yes.
In fact, he has three friends with him who run for cover.
They run for cover because the appearance is so fierce and so otherworldly. You know, J.R., the thing that impresses me about this is that Daniel receives a prophetic vision that spans the time from his own day until the far future, time of great tribulation. And the prophecy deals with the princes of Persia and the prince of Greece, and then later with Rome and the Antichrist. And these are the princes he's fighting, because he says in verse 20 of chapter 10 to Daniel, then said he, knowest thou wherefore I come unto thee? You know why I'm coming to you, is what it says. And now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia, and when I am gone forth, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come. These forces that he's fighting with are the very subject of the prophecy that he receives.
Now, the Prince of Greece didn't come for 200 years.
That's right.
Alexander the Great Of course, this Prince of Greece here is the demonic entity who's motivating Alexander the Great. But that's 200 years off. And yet he says, when I'm gone forth, the Prince of Greece shall come. So he's looking into the future, and he speaks of it as if it's, this afternoon or day after tomorrow.
It's amazing. Now, we're going to, we're approaching a break, but when we come back, we're going to address the question, are we seeing battles in the heavens today that are visible to our eyes?
We'll be back in just a moment. Our story opens with Daniel and three friends on the banks of the Euphrates when suddenly Daniel and the men get a vision of Christ. The pre-incarnate or post-incarnate Christ, it is Christ, the same Christ we see in the book of the Revelation. He's on the river. And Daniel falls down on his face. The three men scatter. They go hide. And then Gabriel touches Daniel on the shoulder and says, sit up, Daniel. Stand up, Daniel. I've got something to tell you about. He tells him the story of the Ptolemies and the Seleucids, and from the Seleucids will come the Antichrist. This is a fascinating story that unfolds here because of this battle between light and darkness.
The battle between light and darkness, and we have this incarnation of Christ visiting Daniel, and his appearance is like lightning and molten metal and flames. He is ablaze with light and is always on the side of light. And you know, J.R., this, what's fascinating to me about the 11th chapter of Daniel, hands down, without any question, it's the most complex chapter in the entire Bible. To do a study of Daniel 11 would take weeks.
It covers a lot of history in just a few verses.
In a very few verses, it covers world history. I guess we could say the genealogy of the Antichrist, from the time of Persia until the final emergence of the man of sin.
And isn't it interesting, he talks about these demonic creatures as being the Prince of Persia and the Prince of Greece. And so this family is going to have some kind of interaction with demonic forces.
Right, and it is the very embodiment of the of Paul's writing in verse 12 of Ephesians 6. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness. And that's the word to keep in mind, the operative word here.
Yeah, and to me, the underlying theme here is demon seed. Yeah. You know, go back to Genesis chapter 6, and the sons of God saw the daughters of men, and bred with them, brought forth giants, our men of renown. And let's talk about chapter 2 of Daniel for just a moment. You know, this vision of the monster man seen by Nebuchadnezzar. Yeah. We get down to the feet of iron and clay. That's two different entities. The iron
really
being the, of men of the Roman Empire, and the clay being something else. It says, whereas thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. Now, the only thing other than the seed of men would be the seed of angels, fallen or otherwise.
That's right. It's kind of fascinating that Daniel's explanation to Nebuchadnezzar of world history in a statue. You have a head, eventually it comes down, splits into two legs, which many have said are the eastern and western divisions of the Roman Empire. And that finally the feet, and in the days of the feet and the toes, there becomes a debasing of the material of the statue. It started out as gold and it ended up in iron mixed with clay. And J.R., this is the most perfect image of what happened in Genesis chapter 6 when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, chose wives. They'd so debased the human genome that God said, that's
it. Destroy the human race.
I have to destroy the human race. And he chose Noah, along with seven other people, whose genetic heritage was pure, and brought them through the flood and started the whole thing out over again. Well, when Daniel says here, in explaining the statue, whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. Has to be other than men. And the next sentence is fascinating, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. In other words, An attempt will be made to corrupt the human genome once again.
Yes.
But it will not work. That's the good news.
Yes. Well, you know, when we get to chapter 11, verse 21, we go from the Ptolemies and the Seleucids to the Antichrist. Mm-hmm. From verse 20 to 21,
that's
suddenly
right.
In his estate shall stand up a vile person. This, to me, sounds like the Antichrist will be of Seleucid background, mm-hmm. but demon seed mixed.
A vile.
An alien human hybrid.
Which, now, if you're beginning to say out there, hold on, J.R.
We're talking UFO abductions here, aren't
yeah,
we?
Yeah, J.R. and Gary have lost it.
But
we want to demonstrate, we won't have time to finish this today, but we want to demonstrate to you that there is a battle in the heavens going on, and the battle involves the corruption of humanity. Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah. Now, the days of Noah, J.R., are seen in Genesis chapter 6, and the feature that marks the days of Noah is the genetic corruption of mankind.
Now, Gary, you got to admit that only in this generation, in this 20th century, mm-hmm. have men learned that we are made up, our human bodies are made up of a DNA program.
Yeah.
Some kind of mix, and every one of us are different, but we are all made up of this basic genetic structure. Up until then, nobody knew that we were made up of some kind of scientifically contrived DNA program.
Right.
So that our eyes would be either blue or brown or so on, and our hair would be a certain color and features as they are. Now, when we get over to Daniel chapter 11 and verse 39, we've got what appears to be an alien mm-hmm. presence among the human race.
As a matter of fact, reading that, we have this: thus shall he do, he being the Antichrist, in the most strongholds with a strange god, one whom he shall acknowledge and increase with glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many. Yeah. Which they are. Who are they who are ruling over many?
They're these beneficent aliens and the UFOs that are going to come and save the human race from nuclear war.
The subject of practically every motion picture lately.
There you go.
I'm holding a book here that was published a couple of years ago, very well received. By Dr. John Mack. He is a Harvard professor, an MD, a psychiatrist. The man has credentials that go all the way as far as your
arm.
Yeah. And he writes this: the pioneering work of UFO investigators Bud Hopkins and David Jacobs has shown what is amply corroborated in my cases, namely that the abduction phenomenon is in some central way involved in a breeding program that results in the creation of alien-human hybrid offspring. Now, Dr. Mack believes, and this is after doing many, many case studies with people who say they were abducted by UFOs, he believes that space aliens have a genetic engineering program going on. Well, J.R., we would modify his statement in just one simple way by saying, this is the same genetic engineering program that's been going on since Genesis chapter 6. It's not space aliens, it's demons, fallen angels.
They are real. We know they're real. The Bible says they are. We know that angels are real. The Bible says they are. We have this UFO phenomena today.
Mm-hmm.
There are too many reports, too many pictures being taken for it not to be something to it.
And more pictures being taken every day, videotapes being made of flying objects. These creatures are progressively revealing themselves. Now, again, we find ourselves running out of time, but J.R., we haven't even broached the subject of
what
the Bible calls chariots of fire.
Yes.
And next time, I really want to get into those chariots of fire.
Elijah's chariot that took him to heaven.
Yeah.
Ezekiel's chariots that he saw on the plains of mm-hmm. Shinar. And even in Isaiah 66, when it says, behold, the Lord will come with fire in his chariots like a whirlwind.
Now, if you can imagine something that is going through the sky and whirling in flames. What does that sound like? I mean, let's face it, it sounds like something that's reported many, many times in the modern world.
It's going to be a fascinating program. The next one we talk about as we conclude our study here. The interesting thing here is that Daniel has a book given to him, and he says, close the book. In Revelation, we see this same man opening the book. The man is Jesus Christ. Wow.